Hi guys, in this video we'll discuss about the exhaust gas recirculation and the accretion of micro-sized soot particles on walls of longitudinal finite tube heat exchanger. So when the exhaust gas recirculation, it need to pass through a heat exchanger in order to remove the heat so that the efficiency of the engine would increase compared to the non-removal of heat. So when it is passing through the heat exchangers, there is every probability that the soot particles get accumulated inside the heat exchanger. So at what rate the particles are getting accumulated and what effects it has on the heat exchange properties, that we will discuss in this tutorial. And we try to simulate that accretion in ANSYS Fluent Academic version also, so that it will be much more clear to you guys. So these are the learning objectives what we are, I intend to tell you in this video. One is the introduction about exhaust gas recirculation, what are the advantages of exhaust gas recirculation, and all those information. The second point is the role of heat exchanger in exhaust gas recirculation. The third one is accretion of accretion on walls. The accretion, accretion means the deposition of the soot particles or deposition of any particles on the walls. And the discrete phase method (DPM) simulation setup in the ANSYS Fluent. The next one is a description about the accretion UDF. So in this case, I have compiled an UDF in order to calculate the amount of soot particles that are getting deposited on the walls. So for that, I have created one UDF. I'll just explain the UDF in this part. And next one is the post-processing. Okay. Let's go through the introduction in EGR. So in many countries around the world, the emissions of NOx from diesel and gasoline vehicles are restricted by legislation. So NOx is formed due to the combustion chamber of the engines when high temperatures cause oxygen and nitrogen to react. So in order to reduce these NOx emissions, in generally we will pass that exhaust gas so that the oxygen requirement or the oxygen sent to the cylinder would be reduced and the formation of NOx also reduces. So widely adopted route is to reduce NOx emissions is exhaust gas recirculation, as I have mentioned. So this involves recirculating a controllable proportion of engine exhaust back into the intake air. So now if you can see here, so this orange part is the exhaust gas. So but part of this exhaust gas is sent back to the inlet manifold such a way that so that the oxygen requirement the oxygen which is sent to the engine would reduce and it is combined with the exhaust gas so that the formation of NOx also reduces. And the presence of a heat exchanger here, it is very important because the temperature of the exhaust gas would reduce and in turn the engine's temperature also reduces, which have a positive impact on the production of NOx. So if the temperature of the engine reduces, NOx emissions also reduce. So next one, the substitutions of burnt gases which takes no further part in combustion for oxygen-rich air reduces the proportion of the cylinder contents available for combustion. So this causes a corresponding lower heat release and peak cylinder temperature and reduces the formation of NOx. So the presence of inert gas in the cylinder further limits the peak temperature. So these are all points which briefly describes about the exhaust gas recirculation. So now I need just have a brief discussion about that role of heat exchanger. So you can see the gas to be recirculated through the EGR cooler, so which is usually air or water type heat exchanger mode. So this reduces the temperature of the gas, which reduces the cylinder charge temperature when EGR is employed. So this has two benefits. One is a reduction of charge temperature results in lower peak temperature. The greater density of cooled EGR gas allows high proportion of EGR to be used. So on a diesel engine, the recirculated fraction may be less, or sorry, may be as high as 50% under same operating conditions. So now we can see here, so part of the exhaust gas is again recirculated and sent back to the inlet manifold. So before going into the inlet manifold, there is an EGR cooler here where it cools down the temperature of the exhaust gas. So this is the EGR cooler in the actual engine. This is the actual prototype of the engine. So you can see here, there is an exhaust gas pipe and through which the exhaust gas will be added to the engine. So in between there is a cooler in order to reduce the temperature. So accretion on the walls. So when this exhaust gas is passing through the different parts of heat exchanger, so there is every probability that soot particles and carbon particles which are present in the exhaust gas can accumulate on the walls of the heat exchanger, which in turn reduces the effectiveness of heat exchanger. So what are the proportion that is been getting accumulated on the wall prior to manufacturing an engine with EGR, we need to get. So that information we can get using ANSYS Fluent simulations. So where we can find out what is the amount of ash particles or soot particles that would deposit on in an heat exchanger with respect to time on a given area. So this I'm trying to use the discrete phase method in the ANSYS Fluent in order to discuss or given complete overview how much number of or how many number of particles that would accumulate on the walls of an heat exchanger. So these are the effects which I just want to involve in the DPM. So first one is thermophoresis. So it is also called as thermomigration, thermodiffusion, or the Sorette effect. So it is a phenomenon observed in the mixture of mobile particles. So where the different particle types exhibit different responses to the force of a temperature gradient. So due to the temperature gradient, so there is a force that would be acting on these particles. So with respect to these temperature gradients, the micro-sized particles can have a different effect. So micro-sized particles effect on the heat exchange, how it exactly takes place, or how the particles movement effect on the continuous phase. So the, all those items we will discuss in the coming simulation. So next one is two-way turbulence coupling. So two-way turbulence coupling is like discrete particles turbulence motion as well as continuous particle turbulence motion, how we'll couple using this two-way turbulence coupling. This model also will be getting activated in the DPM method. The next one is Safman lift force. So Safman lift force is not the regular lift force what we see, that is the aerodynamic lift force. This Safman lift force is due to the viscous stresses that are present inside the boundary layer. So the shear fields or that shear stresses which present inside the boundary layer are responsible for this Safman lift force. So this lift force will be perpendicular to the direction of the flow. So and this shear lift originates from the inertia effects on the viscous flow. And these lift force would be insignificant if the size of the particles is higher compared to the regular particle size. So and the next one is erosion and accretion. Obviously, erosion and accretion we need to activate in order to find out the amount or number of the particles that are getting accumulated onto the walls of an heat exchange. So these are the main models which I'll activate in the DPM in order to have an effect. So first one is thermophoresis, second one is two-way turbulence coupling, third one is Safman lift force, and next one is erosion and accretion. So we'll just go through the simulation how exactly I have set. So this is the model what have prepared. So this extrusion where you can see, so this is an inlet and this is an EGR outlet. The center pipe is a pipe in which the exhaust gas has been sent. And this is a longitudinal tube heat exchanger. So here you can see the fins which are present on the surface of the exhaust gas pipe. And this red color part is the water fluid which is passed to. Right. So this is a counter flow heat exchanger where EGR in is water out and water in is EGR out. So here I'm first using the steady state process. I've not activated gravity because the gravity effect compared to the turbulence effect maybe can be neglected, so I've just neglected it, or else you can activate the gravity from your side also. So I've activated the viscous model with K epsilon, realizable and scalable wall functions. I've also activated the energy on. So in the materials, just go to the materials, click on create edit. In the fluid database, select water liquid, copy and close. So automatically in the materials panel, you can see now the water liquid. So now you just go to cell zone conditions. So solid is for fins and fluid is for exhaust gas as well as water. So exhaust gas, I am just patching it with the air. So the properties are very nearby to the air. So exhaust gas properties have patched with air material name. And for water fluid, I would use the water liquid. So this is a water liquid. And for solid, it's aluminium itself. So I'll just show you the inlets. So this is a EGR, velocity inlet. So I have given a velocity of 2 meters per second and the temperature as 400 Kelvin. So this is an EGR inlet and this is your EGR outlet. Similarly, this is your water inlet and this is your water outlet. So I'll just attach the case file to the description below, so you can go through the case file. And the next one is water inlet. So velocity of water, what I've considered is 1 meter per second and temperature as 300 Kelvin. In the outlet conditions, I have left with the pressure outlet on the both sides of EGR as well as water. Right. So now I'll try to initialize it. Okay. And I'll try to run calculate with 1000 number of iterations with the default residual or convergence criteria. So, guys, you can see that now the solution has been converged. So now we will try to activate the DPM, discrete phase method. So in which the exhaust gas particles like soot particles, all those you can trace. So I'll just activate, click on discrete phase. I'll click on interaction with continuous phase. So there's a two-way interaction and the physical models. So thermophoretic force, Chapman lift force, virtual mass force, pressure gradient force, erosion and accretion, and two-way turbulence coupling. So virtual mass force is nothing. It's like if the two particles, when they're interacting, one phase has or one particle has huge acceleration. So then this virtual mass force concept comes into a role. So with respect to one phase or with respect to one particle, if the continuous phase has a huge acceleration, then you can use this virtual mass force concept. The pressure gradient force, obviously the gradient of the pressure which creates the force on the particles or the discrete phase. So that if you need to have the that model also activated, then you need to tick this, right? So still this is point is okay. So now I'll click on okay. Now I'll try to create an injection. So click on create. So in the injection, I will try to select the anthracite as a basic kinet particles. And I will just select from surface the particles are being injected. That is EGR1. This is the surface from which the particles are being injected. And I'll select inject using the phase normal direction. So it is the direction which indicates through which the particles are being sent into the exhaust gas medium. And in the loss, you need to activate inert heating. So inert heating means the exhaust gas particles are at 400 Kelvin, but the water is at 300 Kelvin. So there would be a temperature drop from 400 to 300 also. So that if you want to have the effective, or if you just you want the heat transfer between the particles and the medium also, then you need to activate inert heating option, that is first law. Click on OK. And by default, you can say the total flow rate is 10⁻². Maybe I'll just reduce it to 10⁻¹. So if you reduce further reduce to -5 or -4, then the particle tracking would be very unsteady. So then you need to go for transient simulation. If you try to simulate in the study, you will get very annoying results, or the residuals will not converge, it just oscillate. So which indicates that it is a transient simulation. So just go to the physical models and spherical drag law, what I'm using here. And in the turbulent dispersion, I'll just use a discrete random walk model and activate a random eddy lifetime. So these model helps into situating the particles within the medium, that is a continuous medium, right? So this is very important in order to activate the turbulent dispersion. So indicates the position of the particles. Click on OK. right? I'll just close it. Now I'll just select the exhaust gas wall onto which the particles get accreted, so that accreted particles would be on this wall aluminium water shadow. So I think it's exhaust gas, right? So it is an exhaust gas shadow. I'll just add to it is exhaust gas. It is not water shadow, it is exhaust gas. So aluminium exhaust gas shadow. This is the wall on which the particles will get accumulated. I just don't want to use the default options of reflect conditions. So I just want to use an user defined function. So for that, before activating that, I'll just show you the UDF, what exactly I'm using here. So this is the UDF what I want to use here. So this is the DPM boundary conditions, which signifies it is a boundary condition type UDF with the BC underscore reflect option. And these are all the variables what I have declared, with the normal coefficient as 1 and the tangential coefficient as 0.3. So what is normal and tangential coefficient? I'll just show you the. So in one dimensional collision between two objects which are moving with the relative velocities of UA and UB, initial velocity of object A and initial velocity of object B. So after impact, the velocities would change in the perfect inelastic collision. So the values would be changed to VA and VB. So now the coefficient of restitution is VB minus VA by UA minus UB. So here our one object is wall and the other object is our particles. We can consider the object A as a wall, so that UA is equals to 0, VA is equals to 0. So and the coefficient of restitution is VB by UB or minus UB. So VB by minus UB. But this coefficient of restitution can be in tangential direction or in normal direction. So this coefficient of restitution, so can be for tangential, it can be one value. For normal, it can be other value. So these are the two values what I have given. One is the real normal coefficient value, 1, and the real tangential coefficient value as 0.3. So the real normal 3 is an array with 3 as its structure, and idim is equal to dim, where dim is a three-dimensional indication. So it comes from the by default settings. So as our geometry is three-dimensional, dim automatically gets into the value of 3. So there is all the values what have initialized, these are all the variables what I've initialized. And for this loop, I'm just introducing I equals to 0 for I less than idim I plus plus. So it means that I have assigning f normal of 0, so it is a x direction normal to normal of 0. Similarly, f normal of 1, so y direction normal to normal of 1. So in this way, I'm assigning all the three normals in x, y, z direction to the normal I. So if type of TP underscore type is equals to init, so then it will go into this loop. So obviously ours is a net, so it will go into this loop. It tries to calculate all these values. So in the calculation of these values, it will try to calculate the normal velocity and similarly tangential velocity. So with respect to normal velocity and tangential velocity, it tries to use this value of tangential coefficient and normal coefficient, and it tries to calculate the normal value, tangential values, velocities after the impact with the walls. So after the calculating those values, now we need to have to ascertain whether these combined values of normal velocity and tangential velocity are sufficient enough the particle to reflect back from the wall, or if the velocity is not sufficient, it will just adhere or accrete onto the wall. So this is the condition what we need to give. So it is an conditional statement. So for that conditional statement, what I have given is the capture velocity. So if the net velocity is greater than capture velocity, then they will reflect, or else it will get accreted. So this is a general formula what we get in the literature for the capture velocity, which is 0.60515 by diameter of the particle. So diameter of the particle I've already considered in the UDF. You can just see above. So the diameter, you can get it from the TP underscore diam of TP. So TP is a particle track. TP is called as a particle track, from which we'll get the diameter. We'll introduce into it, and we'll calculate the square of the Vmag. Square of the Vmag is nothing but velocity in the direction x. square plus velocity in the direction y square plus the velocity in the direction z square. Again, velocity in the x means it is the velocity in the normal plus velocity in the tangential. Velocity in the y means velocity in the normal and velocity in the tangential in y direction. Similarly, the velocity along z means velocity of the normal in the z and velocity along the tangential in the z direction. So from that we'll get velocity tp in the different x, y, z direction. So the velocity of magnitude is less than the capture velocity, then the particles would be adhered onto the walls and will accreted on the walls. So velocity of that would be zero, or else the path would be active and they will return back to or have a reflect conditions and they will travel in the domain. So if it is that is zero, then I'll just try to abort the particles path. So now after this, I'll just click on save. And hook the function, go to compiled, browse that file where it is exactly present. Okay. Try to build it. So after that, you just go to the exhaust gas wall shadow. And go to user defined function, and it is libuty of 334. Click on OK and just run for other one iteration. It would be sufficient for the accretion rate how it is happening. So now you can see the DPM accretion rate onto the exhaust gas tube. So you can see these are the points where the accretion is been occurring. So these points indicate that the velocity is very, very low enough to get accreted there. So according to our, if the velocity magnitude is less than the capture velocity, then so the velocity becomes zero and the path will be aborted. That means the particle would be stuck onto the exhaust gas tube. So these are the points where the velocities of the particles are very low and they are getting stuck, or that accretion has been happening onto the tubes. So I can so these are the streamlines along which that exhaust gas flow has been happening, and across this there is a heat transfer. Maybe I'll just activate wall function also here. So here also you can see the accretion rate, how the accretion has been happening at different parts, right? So this is the accretion region that would be happen if the particles are released. So I think, guys, maybe I'll just show you the fins also and how the temperature is also getting distributed. So here the temperature, how it is getting varied, because from one side water is inlet, other from other side water is outlet. So I'll just show you the outlet water also. So it would be water wall. I will just show. So you can see the water temperature here. So at this point there is an exhaust out and there is water in, so the temperature has been maximum there and it was been reducing as it is going towards the exhaust in. So I'll just stop this. So you can see the variation of the temperature, how it is happening along these longitudinal fins. So this video helps in understanding that longitudinal finite-to-bit exchanger as well as the DPM, where the accretion is most important, where the particles just get deposited on the walls. So you can just play with all the things what exactly you require, and if you have any queries or you want any doubts or anything, yeah, you can just place in the comment section, so I'll try to respond and I'll just answer them. Thank you. So please do subscribe the channel and encourage me for me